Gods, Guns, and Guitars. And it's three authors discussing Islam in transition. Our first author was the Pakistani rock star Salman Ahmed. Tonight we present Rob Asghar, and on April 26th we present Reza Aslan as he launches the paperback version of his book, How to Win a Cosmic War. So we hope you'll join us for that as well. And I'll also plug another book signing that Spectrum and Office of Religious Life are doing with Jim Wallace, Reverend Jim Wallace, one of the leading progressive evangelical voices in the United States, a faith-based advisor to President Obama. He'll be here signing and talking about his new book on February 25th, which is a Thursday, 6th, sorry. February 26th, which is a Thursday, and there's information in the back. His new book is called Rediscovering Values on Wall Street, Main Street, and Your Street, a very timely book, so we hope you'll join us for that. And lastly, for all you who love vegetarian organic cuisine, we've launched a twice-a-week pure vegetarian lunch service called the Good Karma Cafe. It's Wednesdays and Thursdays from 12 to 2. Everyone's invited. It's in the courthouse of the United University Church, which is on our campus on 34th Street. So for those of you who want to join us, please do. There's also more information in the back. Tonight we come together to celebrate the release of Rob Asghar's new book called Lessons from the Holy Wars, a Pakistani-American Odyssey. As many of you know, Rob Asghar is a Pakistani-American political writer whose essays and commentaries have appeared in more than 30 newspapers around the world, including the Wall Street Journal, the Chicago Tribune, and the Los Angeles Times. He's also been a columnist for Creators Syndicate and is currently a regular blogger for the Huffington Post. Who's not a regular blogger? And the Los Angeles Daily News. In his new book, Rob discusses the lifetime he has spent attempting to please people and make peace among people and cultures, only to find that happiness comes from letting people down and allowing them to scruffle within good reason. The format of tonight's event will be Rob will discuss his book for the first 10 or 15 minutes, then he and I will have a conversation for about 30 minutes, and then we'll open it up for questions and answers. After that, you'll be able to purchase and have Rob sign your book. So please join me in welcoming to USC our friend Rob Asghar.
Thank you, Varun, and thank you all for being here. I know we've got people who came all the way down, family and friends from South Orange County, all the way up to my drinking buddies up the street. So thank you all for being here, dear old friends and others who've been able to come out here. I want to thank Varun. I don't know if you guys realize, in the 18 months or so that Varun's been here, he's made a huge contribution to the campus community, the university community. He's been a great champion of religious pluralism and tolerance and discussions about interfaith dialogue and so on. And I don't know if you realize that every university has a chaplain or dean of religious life. Varun is the first and only Hindu chaplain at any American university. And I think still the only non-Christian chaplain or dean of religious life at any American university. So you might see that as a sign of progress or a sign of the apocalypse, depending on your perspective. But he's been a terrific addition to the campus. And for myself, as Varun said, I want to say, make a few observations from my book, and then we will have some time. Varun and I will discuss a few things that we have time for your questions and your comments and your angry denunciations. But I want to start with a certain kind of observation, which is, again, I did oftentimes for many years feel I was this kind of a pacifistic person who really believed that societies need to learn how to get along. Societies need to learn how to make peace and so on and so forth. We should all join hands and sing great songs. And I finally came out of that. I finally decided, no, that's just not going to happen. And I want to say a little bit about that, which is there's something called coalition aggression. It's an evolutionary psychology term. And coalition aggression means that we like to form groups of people. Yes, we are built for community, but only to a point. We like to build community, to have a little group of people, and then we go and beat up another group of people. That's what coalition aggression, that's how we are wired. This is what we are meant to do. And here's a great example of it. If you look at, say, USC, let's say we had a canned food drive here. If you have a canned food drive here, and we just say, come on, help out folks in need. Who do you think would give more? Who do you think would contribute more? Women or men?
Women.
Women? You're right. And you can sit there and think, okay, well, that's just USC, but let's try UCLA. Maybe public school down the road. Maybe UCLA is different. What do you think would happen? Women. But now let's change that. Now you announce this is a competition between USC and UCLA. See who can raise more food and canned food and so on for the poor. Now who do you think is going to give more, men or women?
Men.
You sort of knew that intuitively, didn't you? But that is what they find. That is coalition aggression. Men are especially good at it for some reason. That men, this drives men in terms of how they deal with cultures and societies and organizations and politics. But this is not to say women are all pacifistic. You've got Sarah Palin, for example. Is anybody more combative than that one? So this is not purely a male thing. It is a human thing. It's especially a male thing. But it does show you how you've got something like universities. We say universities are meant to represent the highest aspirations of human ideals in terms of knowledge and in terms of community, in terms of what we're aspiring to do, create new knowledge and so on, as knowing new opportunities. And yet, we hate the college down the street. I would be perfectly happy if they split into the ocean. Sorry. Or vice versa for the UC people here. But that shows you how great our combative urge is. And so ultimately, what I came to find was that through years of spiritual journeys, I moved away from the idea that we were all going to fall in love with each other, and rather came to believe, at a more practical level, maybe we're just going to learn and get along in certain times if there are certain practical incentives. Not as some kind of a big spiritual epiphany, but rather people will fight. You've got to find the right things for them to fight over that will allow them to not cause too much damage, limiting that. A personal lesson that I want to share from the book is, we call it Lessons from the Holy Wars. It's got a series of observations and lessons about what I saw going on in the world. One that is more personal is, learn to be a disappointment. And I thought to myself, okay, that's on page 126, learn to be a disappointment. Then I thought to myself, most of you probably know how to be a disappointment, right? That's not the hard part. If you're a student, well, if you're anybody who's got family, right? You know how to be a disappointment. You know how to let people down. So maybe the issue isn't how to be a disappointment. The issue is how to survive being a disappointment. Because I'd say that if you can actually learn how to be disappointment and then survive being a disappointment, you have a fighting chance to be the person you really want to be, to do what you really want to do, and to go where you really want to go. Because most of us live lives of disappointment management. Most of us live lives where we're just trying to kind of just tamp down the disappointment, not do it too much, not crush people too much, and just gently do it. And my thing is, sometimes you just have to, there's a line from Martin Luther, if you're gonna sin, sin boldly. And I take the same attitude toward disappointment. If you're just gonna do it, just do it. Don't treat it like a bandage. Don't try to pick on it slowly. You know, if you do that, it ends up just getting worse and worse. You cause more pain over the long haul, more of a mess. Just rip that thing off. And what I found in my life was, you do survive. If you were from a traditional culture, it is tougher. I've got my brother here from Orange County, who, if you're the firstborn male in a Pakistani family, there are obligations, there are expectations, there's pressure. But he can write his own book. In my case,
well, Mom, you wrote this?
I told Mom I wrote this, finally. We can talk more about that later. So what I found for myself, it was, there is one true college in America. Harvard, right? If you don't go to Harvard, you're mediocre. There is one true profession for Pakistanis, medicine. But I don't like the sight of blood, and I stink at science and math. So you learn to be a disappointment. There was one true religion. I didn't do a really good job of following that one either. I didn't do all of the things that they believed weren't what I was supposed to do. So at some point there, being a crushing, colossal disappointment, my father would let me know about it and write letters saying, Yuka, you ruined my life. 5 years there, he's still around. I say, look, your life can't be that road. You're doing okay. But they say, no, you're really hurt. One point my father tells me, You're the second worst person alive. And you need to read the book to see who came in number one. I'm not gonna tell you. And how I finally stole the top spot in that son of a bitch. But also there were great moments of reconciliation. And this is my point about surviving being disappointed. And no, you were not number one. But what I realized was that sometimes you survive being a disappointment to the people who are closest to you because you realize it's not personal. We're all fighting battles. There's that line from Philo that be kind for everyone you meet is fighting a hard battle. And that the people in your life who might be taking it personally, they're being dragged into a battle they didn't really want. That it's not that you did it, but somehow by you doing something, you not living up to a certain measure, you not meeting a certain hope, confronts them with how do I make sense of my life? That's not a bad thing. And I feel like the people in my life who I let down went through a wrestling, soul-searching process, and oftentimes came out thinking better, thinking smarter, thinking more lucidly than before. This is not to give me all the credit for I made the right decisions, they got better. I might have pissed them off at making the wrong decisions. I might have later said, never mind, I changed my mind again. But still, that process for them was really good. And that process, that for me, is what sort of gave me that sense that I can keep going on and keep being a crushing disappointment to people, which gives me hope for the future. But that is my favorite personal kind of lesson, because I feel, to me, that is the key to actually being able to live with yourself and not live a life that somebody else thinks will fit good on you. Maybe it doesn't, and maybe it shouldn't. And so with that, Varun, he's got some tough questions for you.
Okay. We did this earlier, and with Salman Ahmed, and I was sitting on a chair, and Rob said, I couldn't see you from the back because you're so short, so today we've graduated to stools, and hopefully you'll all be able to see us.
We tower above you.
Yes. So let's start with, before we get into the substance of the book, I'd like to talk about the process of writing this book. This book is deeply personal, it's extremely intimate. At times when you read it, it's almost like reading someone's journal. You talk about family politics, you talk about your struggles with depression and with alcohol, you talk about your loss of faith and your experience with being born again. What was it like as a writer to bare your soul in this way, to be so, in a way, naked in front of your audience? And what inspired you to write your first book in this kind of, with this approach?
I'd say that people love for you to be open when you're saying something they agree with, and they hate it when they don't agree with you. That I think there's people who, as I went through my faith journey, some of it is the idea of that peculiar position in which I came up through conservative Islam, went atheist for many years, went New Agey, went evangelical Christian, drifted again, bummed people out when I did that, and so. At various points when I was with a group of people in terms of this is, I'm with you, they loved me to be candid and open about it. When I moved away, they say, shut up. You don't need to be so open. So everyone has a different sense of TMI, right? But for myself, I probably am a high disclosure person, personally. Not a lot of people would necessarily talk about some of the stuff in there about medication or whatever that I just sit there and say, okay, I'm gonna mention this. It's embarrassing, you don't do that, especially coming from a traditional thing. So which is why, at times, my parents would freak out and say, why are you writing about these things? And my brother asked me once, he said, this is all nice and everything, but why don't you write about the Lakers or something? something that's not gonna quite, and mom's not gonna sit there and say, oh, you ruined our life again. But I think I was reading something that my sort of mentor, Warren Bennis, who wrote the foreword to the book, he wrote something recently in a magazine, and he was saying, it was a weird thing. He writes about leadership, right? And he says, I study leadership, I write it, I try to analyze it, because I feel like somehow it makes people feel less alone. And I thought, that's interesting. I don't think you write about leadership to make people, well, maybe, because leadership's a lonely business, right? Mm-hmm. But then I thought to myself, yeah, I think I write in the hope that people will feel less alone, and maybe I will write other people will connect with it and say, yeah, that's been my experience too. And when I write some of this stuff, I do get hate mail. People saying, no, this is terrible. You're a jerk. Why do you have to ruin, why do you have to make fun of what we are by repudiating it in some sense or admitting that you left it behind or whatever. But somehow there's other people who say, I felt like I was less alone when I saw your wife death. So that's kind of the motivation.
The title of your book is A Pakistani-American Odyssey, and you have the unique experience of having lived in Pakistan and having lived in the U.S. And now we're at a point in a relationship between the U.S. and Pakistan, which has been a long-standing strategic relationship, where we're allies in the war on terror in terms of a government-to-government interaction. But in terms of a people-to-people interaction, Pakistanis have a lot of bad blood against Americans. Increasingly, polls say that Pakistanis want the U.S. to leave Pakistan. Americans have a lot of stereotypes against Pakistanis. So, given your unique vantage point, what do Pakistanis need to learn about Americans in the U.S.? And what do Americans need to learn about Pakistan? And what can they learn from each other?
I'd say Pakistanis probably take a lot of things really personally. There's a sense in which they just kind of believe that America, whether you define that as Washington or the American people as a whole and all that, there's distrust. Do they respect us as a people? Do they prefer you Indians over there? Mm-hmm. Do they play favorites? That we supported America during the Cold War, India aligned with the Soviets, now we're sort of like a ditched lover. And so there's this bitterness, and sometimes they take it a little bit personally, but that's kind of that passionate subcontinent kind of a approach, right? There's a real strong sense of passion, and they get hopping mad about things. They shouldn't take certain things so personally. Washington is in some ways stumbling around doing the best it can. There's not one government over the last 40 years with a consistent path policy. It's rather a bunch of people running around changing their minds every couple of years, being voted out of office and so on. What Americans need to realize is have some appreciation of that Pakistan did try in many ways to align as best as it could with the U.S. After the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan and Pakistan helping out, there's a sense in which the U.S. left Pakistan and just allowed Pakistan to get overrun by a couple million Afghan refugees, which drained the economy, which a lot of these people were the fanatics who helped to drive out the Soviets, and they were the seeds of Al-Qaeda and the Taliban. And so there's not always a proper appreciation of that. How many of you saw Charlie Wilson's War? You guys know Charlie Wilson died today?
Yeah.
And so that guy, you can read different histories of that war, and depending on the history of it, you'll hear some people say, obviously his biographer says, oh, that guy was crucial, that quotes the Pakistani president saying it was Charlie who helped us get the Soviets out and win the Cold War. Other people would say, if you read Ghost Wars, they'll take a much broader view at all. They'll say, no, he was just one player in there. Point is, a lot of people were involved. Pakistan got really involved. Pakistan felt just jilted after all that. And so there's a lot of lingering bitterness about it. There's a sense in which when we say we're going to give Pakistan huge aid, more than almost any other country gets, they say it's peanuts compared to what you're throwing into Iraq and so on. You just don't really, you're not really helping us be the country we want to be. And so that's something that we as Americans don't quite know how to appreciate.
And you and I have discussed this before. I think we're both somewhat critical of the American AFPAC strategy in terms of conceptualizing the war on terror. You have contended in your writing that actually the real issue is Pakistan-India. And here we sit, Indian-American, Pakistani-American, Hindu, Muslim, we're able to have a civil conversation. You're a fellow at USC Center on Public Diplomacy. What is the future of diplomacy for India and Pakistan? And is cultural diplomacy enough? A few weeks ago, we were talking with Salman Ahmed, who said, it's about cultural diplomacy. It's about Bollywood bringing people together. It's about soap operas that people are watching. It's about the fact that we speak the same language, and we eat the same food, and we watch cricket, and those cultural diplomatic initiatives have brought people across the border closer. What is your take on cultural diplomacy with India and Pakistan? And what are the limits, perhaps, of cultural diplomacy?
I think it could be good. Salman, by the way, was the reason this series was titled God, Guns, and Guitars.
He's a guitar player.
I just brought my accordion. But
he just brought his gun.
Right.
You can't say that about Pakistanis. So, there's something about the idea that culturally, that there's a real common culture. Pakistanis love Bollywood movies. Pakistanis love, and there are Muslims in India who are top Bollywood people, and so on. There's a lot of common ground, and there's a sense in which that common ground needs to be exploited. But there's a lot of bitterness and resentment, and this gets at the whole issue of can people just join hands and be kumbaya just for the sake of oneness, or do you need more practical incentives in place? And I think India and Pakistan need. I think the cultural diplomacy is a piece of it, but they need a lot of economic incentives to stop trying to hit beat each other up. Another thing Pakistanis complain about is the sense that India is always calling Pakistan, it's kind of like a sibling rivalry, and India catches Pakistan in the act and says, look America, look what Pakistan did. Pakistan was fomenting terrorism on our soil, and then Pakistan's off-tagged. But there's a lot of Pakistanis who feel India does it to them in Balochistan and so on. That doesn't get called out in the media. So there's a sense in which you always win, you're the big brother, you always kind of get away with it, we don't. That's one issue that Washington could do more for American safety by helping Pakistan and India wrestle through those issues about, all right, who's beating up who started it, what are we gonna do in Kashmir, what are we gonna do in Balochistan, what are we gonna do in Afghanistan, politically, as opposed to just the idea of sustaining the Afghan war, thinking if we just keep on beating up the hillbillies in the Afghan hills and in the northwest frontier of Pakistan, that eventually they'll all submit. Because the fact of the matter is, hitting them on the head just makes their cousins and brothers and sisters angrier.
One of the things that I found fascinating about your book is you're not only coming at it from a Pakistani-American angle, you're also coming at it from someone who self-identified as Muslim and also someone who self-identified as Christian. You were born into a conservative Muslim family, but you walked away from Islam. You were an evangelical Christian for many years, then you walked away from evangelical Christianity. Why'd you walk away from Islam and Christianity, and what advice would you give conservative Muslims and evangelical Christians based on your experiences with both?
In terms of why I would walk is a hard one, because sometimes you don't want to believe that you're walking away from something as much as you're walking towards something else, right? And that again goes to the issue of disappointment. I used to sit there and think to myself, could I make the religious choices I make and be open about it as long as my parents are alive? But then you sit there and think, so what am I supposed to do? Wait till everyone passes away, poison their drinks, or how exactly do you? So to some extent, I just felt drawn to phases of agnosticism, drawn to phases of New Age, drawn to phases of nothing, drawn to phases of generic monotheism, and Marianne Williamson, going to her New Agey talks 20 years ago up in Hollywood Boulevard, and then going again to see her recently. So the idea of drawn to something instead of away, I feel as though, to me, people, in particular with evangelical Christianity, is very much the belief that this is not something you leave. Same with conservative Islam, you just don't leave it. And this is meant to be a lifetime, eternal kind of thing. And yeah, I think I felt a desire to believe that. But I also felt as though, how do you have to define these things? I got tired of the labels at many levels, just tired of the labels. And so the idea is that I used to spend a lot of energy trying to jump through mental hoops, gymnastics, in terms of this is what I can believe, can't believe, and so on. And then if I do later change my mind, get more flexible on an issue or what, how do you do that? What, in terms of advice to what I'd say to people who are still on there is, I felt after 9/11 and after the Iraq War that I was puzzled by how many evangelicals viewed their relationship to the state. That Christianity is, at an Orthodox level, very much in but not of the world. And it's always been tough for Christians since Constantine to figure out how do you actually balance out your belief in the citizenship in this kingdom, this eternal kingdom, with the actual obligations of being a citizen of a state. And it's especially hard when you're a democracy and you can ostensibly claim to be a majority within that democracy. Then you think maybe you prayerfully have managed to have a good country. But it's always been problematic. And I think that Christians probably got a little bit too enmeshed in politics. Yes, it's great to vote, but their identities, especially among evangelicals, got really wrapped up in their sense of, I'm an American. That didn't ring true to me. It disappointed me that a lot of theological authorities and pastors didn't really come out and address that much. The few who did took some real lumps and lost church membership. Mm-hmm. For Muslims, I think there's an incredible victimization mentality going on. There's an incredible sense in which there's a complaint that the world's beating up on us. And I think living well is the best revenge, and it's time for the Muslim world to stop complaining and start living well. And I think if they do that, they'll focus more back on another golden age and get the attention away from what is happening in Israel, what is happening in America, and so on.
I'm sure everyone will have questions about this afterwards, so we'll move on with our conversation. We'll come back and address some of these issues afterwards. Another, I think, extremely engaging aspect of your book is so many of your experiences take place in Los Angeles, in Southern California, and there's a unique type of Angeleno religiosity that you discuss. It's not only the most religiously diverse city on the planet, it's also a home for popular culture and New Age. And there's, I think, a remarkable convergence of factors that make it a uniquely spiritual global city. What are your impressions of Los Angeles as a spiritual city from your experiences for many years here?
I think the word to me that comes to mind is, it's almost like a Rorschach test. How do you feel about the word sterility? How do you feel about the word sterile? It gets a bum rap in some ways, right? But a lot of people like things to be sterile, right? If you have kids, you bring sterile instruments around them, not dirty ones with bacteria. You want purity, you want cleanliness. And so there are two kinds of people, and I think in some ways, when it comes to spirituality, there are people who like sterility, and there's people who like funkiness, mixing it up. And I was watching something recently where Wolfgang Puck is talking about coming to LA, and he says, I came here and I saw all these amazing flavors and foods and spices and ingredients and Thai and Korean and Japanese and this and that, Mexican, all these things, and I just realized we gotta blend this stuff together. That's fusion. And a lot of people think that is great, that's fusion. But I also had a friend who I ultimately found extremely annoying, who believed that there's only one kind of jambalaya, the brown kind, right? If there's red jambalaya, gumbo. If it's a red sauce, that's not gumbo. I said, no, really? It's just not. No, it's not. He is a purist. You don't mix the influences. And I guess the point is, LA is the kind of place where, because it's so diverse, there are a lot of people who like to mix things. At times when I've been in a particular faith tradition, people would say, no. That's cafeteria style spirituality. You don't do that. You follow the pure ancient tradition. And I said, yeah, but isn't there something we can gain by perhaps mixing a few ingredients here? No, that's impure, that's wrong. And I think I believed it, and I tried my best to believe it, but I guess in the end I would rather have fusion than that. And I think LA, if you go to the Bodhi Tree bookstore, any of you guys ever seen the Bodhi Tree up in Melrose? And that place is all about fusion. Actually, I think they're closing soon. Yeah, maybe they're purists are taking over, but you go up there and you got the Christianity books, you got the Islam books, you got the Judaica books, you got the crystals, you got all the funky kinds of New Age kind of stuff, you got the UFO section and stuff like that, and nobody sits there and says, okay, we got to draw the line at UFOs, we got to draw the line at astral projections or whatever. They just kind of, it's all there, and for a lot of Los Angelinos, they love that. This is lit. And so I think that is something distinctive about this place. It allows for great fusion, but I do back off and say that some people hate that. For some people, it's the biggest threat.
Mm-hmm. There was a conclusion that you came to in your book that I found somewhat disturbing for my own life. You say with great confidence that, and I don't want to misquote you here, but you say something to the extent of, Hindus get all the ladies. And as a Hindu, I never found that to be the case. So does that mean that I'm a bad Hindu, or was I doing something wrong, or my brother is a better Hindu?
I think you need to ask your brother. That sounds like he's the guy partying with Kim Kardashian.
Yes, he is. Does that make him a good Hindu? And what is it about Hindus where ostensibly we get the ladies?
I was, and this might be reflect a certain misunderstanding on my part, but no, look. Look at his beautiful wife right there.
Lady.
He took the first one he could. So what I was sort of having some fun with was this idea that I feel like, and I think I am actually learning there's more to it than I first realized, but there's a sense of that I think Hinduism is more open in many ways than Islam about certain kinds of things involving sex, involving Bollywood, involving dancing, all that kind of thing. Now, but one of the things I'm finding the older I get is that it really depends on what strain you're dealing with. I'm finding that when we were growing up, when we were living in America or Pakistan, if we dealt with Pakistanis, they're really conservative, really conservative Muslim. And there's a hell of a lot of them out there who are not conservative at all and would live extremely westernized kinds of lives. I always associated growing up that Hindus in general westernize more easily than Muslims, and partly because drinking is not the big sin in Hinduism that it is in Islam. And you have your kinds of things going on, but certain kinds of things that allow you to kind of mix in a little bit better into American society. Hindu girls don't have to sit there and wear long pants in PE class and look like outcasts in that. But again, I think maybe it's apples and oranges to the extent you're dealing with conservatives versus liberals. I think generally speaking, most Muslims I've seen in recent decades have been fairly conservative. And it is interesting to see, will they perhaps grow more progressive in certain ways, let the details not be so all-consuming for them, things like that.
Well, you've said a lot of provocative things this evening. I think we should open it up for questions and answers. What I'll do is I'll take my microphone here and I'll play Donahue so everyone can hear the questions. If there are any questions, just let me know.
Well, it's not so much of a question, but just sort of a comment I wanted to add to what you spoke about, the kind of conservative strain that you felt is very present amongst Pakistanis. And I think one thing that we can't ignore is about the history, about the 1970s specifically, and the Islamization that took place under General Zia, and like the impact that had on society. And obviously, once you have such a thing going on, like when you, I guess, you know, when you grow up, the things that are growing around you kind of become your reality. That are happening around you kind of become your reality, and what you touch where you touch your base on, you know? Like as you, even as you move abroad, and then especially when you move abroad.
And for those who haven't followed it as much, what did happen was that General Zia took power in the 70s, took it over from Benazir Bhutto's father, and then had him killed, executed. But he was very intense about bringing in an Islamization in Pakistan, starting a lot of the madrasas, the schools that later perhaps taught a lot of extremists there. And so this was a direction that he kind of got the country put on, which did perhaps incubate a lot of the ills that you see in the society now. At the same time, what I love about Charlie Wilson's War is a sense in which it's the whole issue of the law of unintended consequences. There's so many things we all did to contribute to it. That helped perhaps create a breeding ground for extremists. But we, as the United States, brought in a hell of a lot of people to beat the crap out of Soviets. And we didn't just go for the local ones. We went and imported a lot of them. We allowed a lot of them to be imported from the Arab world. And so as much as Zia bred extremism in that part of the world, a lot of the craziest ones came from the Arab countries. And oftentimes, some of the local Afghan types and Pakistani types complained to Washington, these Arab guys are really over the top. They're the ones who would destroy grave markers because it was seen, they were sort of a Taliban before the Taliban. That this was blasphemy to have that sort of a thing. And some of these Afghan guys said, get these people out of here. But we helped bring them in because they were very convenient. They were very helpful to help us fight Soviets. And some people said, should we really be importing all the wackos from other parts of the world, especially the Middle East, to come fight, kill commies? And some of the CIA people and other people said, nobody kills commies better than the wackos. I don't want the nice moderates there. The problem is, we helped put them there. Now, along with what Zia was doing, now then you get the refugee problem after the Soviet pullout and all that. So now all these things are going on. There's crazy people we brought in, there's crazy people that Zia helped breed in a way. But does that make sense?
The expansion of the madrasa system. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but those are another factor. And you could say, we promote democracy in here in the U.S. We promote democracy in places like Pakistan, but we put up with Zia for a pretty long time because he was helpful to us. And so we might have turned a blind eye toward the sort of stuff he was doing. It seemed like a great idea back then. And now we look back and actually we don't look back.
No, we don't, but the thing is that I think even Wilson is more, Charlie Wilson's war is more like a snapshot.
Uh-huh.
And I think it even goes before that, when the plan, I think the architect war would have been more like Brzezinski's under Carter. So it's, I mean, mm-hmm. it's something more like a perpetuation of this idea.
Yeah.
Of a way to handle the situation.
Yeah, I agree. I think the hard part is that whole sense of, you don't always know. When you're solving one problem today, you don't know when you've knocked over Pandora's jar and all the other little demons come out. You just don't know. We don't know, as we're dealing with Iraq and Afghanistan right now, you don't necessarily know. There's a lot of people complaining on all sides about what's being done, what needs to be done. You don't know what's going to happen if you stay at it hard in the northwest frontier of Pakistan. You don't know what's going to happen if you go bomb something in Iran. Sometimes you don't find out for 10, 15 years, and think, oh, didn't see that one coming.
Hello. Okay. Hello. I was wondering if you could comment on where you feel you are now in your spiritual walk, development path, and if you might also be able to elaborate a little further on the characteristics or features that you feel Americans should be aware of in regards to Pakistan, to the people, or to the culture, because my own personal sense is that a lot of times we in the West, we look at the Middle East, and maybe with the exception of Israel, it's like a big blur. We can't tell the difference between one country and another. And what are some of the unique characteristics we should be aware of?
The unique characteristics of?
Of the Pakistani people, the culture, nation, whatever you feel.
I wrote a column a while back for the Center on Public Diplomacy for their blog, and I called Pakistanis a bunch of drama queens. They didn't take that well. They took it like a bunch of drama queens. And they are prone, this might be terrible. How many other Pakistanis are right here? it might be terrible, but Pakistanis are a very passionate bunch. Passionate about everything, about breakfast, lunch, dinner, and about the color of your car and all that. And so there's a great exaggeration about a lot of things. And so everything is really terrific or really horrible and so on. And so sometimes it's kind of like in Iran. You know, they say death to America in the 70s, and everybody said, oh, they really hate us. But they say death to everything. This is just their way of expressing themselves. Sometimes we take it a certain way. But so there's certain things there in terms of they get really worked up. They get overdramatic at times. Then they calm down really fast. It's a little, I don't want to say vibed over, but just good. And so it makes it dicey when you're dealing with that in terms of that you have to not take certain things too personally when you're dealing with them. They will calm down later. But in terms of characteristics, I think people don't realize Pakistanis really have been a very moderate people in spite of the passions. They generally been very moderate. You know, we had Salman here last month. He's a guy who plays a lovey-dovey Sufi music, and let's all get along and all that. A lot of Pakistani culture was built on that kind of Sufi tradition. It was kind of a later, again, an import of some of the other, some of the more extremist kinds of people who brought in more of a Wahhabi and Taliban kind of an impulse. So that's part of it. As to where I'm at in my journey now, it depends what time of day you would ask me. I did, last week, I had a chance to go to dinner with the distinguished gentleman who wrote the foreword to my book, Warren Bennis. We were in Westwood last week, and he and I and a couple of his friends were walking out of a restaurant, and I saw an attractive woman standing up on the sidewalk, and went up and chatted her up for several minutes. And he's sitting there waiting, and finally I left and went back to him. And he says, "Rob, thanks a lot. Leaving us out here in the cold like that while you're hitting on some woman." And I said, "That's no woman. That's my spiritual guru, Marianne Williamson." And so immediately he was pissed off because he was really mad that I didn't introduce him to Marianne. But I said, "Nah, she was bored with me. I didn't have time to bring her over to talk to you." But I used to go to hear Marianne talk 20 years ago and think, "Wow, what a wonderful person with all these great insights and everything's love and yada yada." And kind of went back again recent weeks and thought, "Oh, this is real, some really good stuff here." Some stuff about her style drives me crazy too. So in the end, I sometimes think, and I'm going to share this with a friend who's here tonight, that sometimes I just think to myself that I'm doomed to be an outsider spiritually. I don't know if I'll ever be the perfect inside person who is there to serve communion this Sunday, and then 10 years from now, I'll at some point change my mind and run off in some other direction. But ask me in an hour, am I changing?
I was just wondering if you could specify the practical incentives that you offer as an alternative to the Kumbaya spiritual epiphany.
I shouldn't be too glib about that, in the sense that it changes. But if you look, my recollection is 30 years ago, we'd been in Pakistan for a couple of years. We came back, and 30 years ago, I remember reading in the newspaper a Southern Baptist minister creating controversy because he said, "God doesn't hear the prayers of the Jews." And I don't think you could find a Southern Baptist these days who doesn't just do anything other than talk about how great Israel is and how the Jews are a blessed people. Things change. And Billy Graham got into a lot of trouble 50 or so years ago when he went to dare have breakfast with Catholics, those horrible Catholics. And today, conservative evangelicals and Protestants and Catholics love to go fight battles over social conservatism over politics. Mormons might have been anathema to some evangelicals some years ago. Now, it can be like this. I want Romney to be president because he will bring the right... So the point is, sometimes there are practical... People shift away from certain kinds of things that they think... 100 years ago, this demographer, Philip Jenkins, wrote that 100 years ago, Protestants treated Catholics coming to America the way they worry now about Muslims coming to America. Things change, and alliances shift. The question is, can you creatively create an alliance where you get people off one direction, get them off one obsession with beating up an enemy, and create a practical alternative to them? Oftentimes, money, economic opportunities, things like that can be good. For Pakistan and India, if they just spend a certain amount of time, less energy, brain cells, dollars, everything, guns, amassing at each other's border, they can try to create an economic zone that might actually be able to really help each side in the next century. It's not an incredibly hopeful thing at some level, I know, but to me, though, it still feels like that is more tangible to me, just the idea of, we'll somehow all magically explode into global peace.
Thanks. Okay, so you're in a room of, say, 25 Pakistani friends. You're watching the Super Bowl. And at the end of the game, Drew Brees says, "Our winning was part of God's master plan." He said master plan. I noted that. What's their reaction?
Depends on their Saint fans.
I'm just wondering whether we cloak our fanaticism in ways that we think are acceptable. It wasn't an expression of anything but a warm wish, and how that's seen from the
outside. That could be seen as in certain ways by I think there are people in the Middle East misunderstood George Bush at some level when he said that something about, I think God wanted us to go to war with Iraq. But I was talking to my other brother in Cincinnati a while back, and I was telling him about how a lot of Christians believe God is giving them guidance. And he said, like, talking to them? Yeah. And the more I realized, in his belief system, and he's more of a devout, he's a devout Muslim. In his belief system, God doesn't talk to you. God talks to prophets. Prophets write it down and come talk to you. So he was amazed. Average, ordinary Christians actually feel like, oh, I should go to Columbia, not to Penn. God wants me to do this. God gave special favor upon me in the Super Bowl. Yeah, you get people who get in a fight and they believe God is going to be with them. But I'm sure they chuckle over the Super Bowl idea. But yeah, there's a lot of things that, depending on your vantage points, seem foreign. Ross.
I read an essay I thought was quite brilliant by you in the Huffington Post, which suggested that Pakistani Americans and Pakistani nationals lose their victim mentality and become more open-minded to the realities of the differences between their cultures, that is the American culture and the Pakistani culture. And it was so well articulated. It was a really beautiful thing. One of my favorite essays of yours. I don't know if it's included in your book, but the real question I have at heart here is, in the Middle East in general, and I know that Pakistan's not the Middle East, but we're talking about Islamic sensibilities and how much it's pervasive in the Middle East. Administration after administration in my lifetime has sent bumbling idiots of varying degrees into these cultures to talk to them about making peace and making amends. But Americans as a culture, and I'm sorry to say if it offends anybody, are the world's greatest narcissists. And so self-obsessed and
you
so self-involved. Well, no, but I mean, there's American hegemony in the world that makes them greater narcissists than even aspiring narcissists in countries that have less power. We are the most powerful narcissists in the world, maybe not, you know, the most successful. Anyway, if there was a way to make a foray into the Islamic world, particularly in Pakistan, that would be less error-filled, if there was a route that you could choose for American diplomacy in Afghanistan and in Pakistan, is there something that you would suggest? Is there a course that you would go?
Yeah, I'd say, I don't know. One of the problems we have with this war on terror, we might be using different terms now, but it's just semantics, but because Obama strikes many people as a wimp, Obama, I think, feels like he needs to kick some ass. And so during the campaign, he mentioned he was going to go do the predator drone bombings. There's a lot of people who believe we got to get out there and do it ourselves because the Pakistani military is ineffective. There's a sense in which Pakistan hasn't been as effective as it can be in fighting the terrorists. In many ways, they feel they have other problems. They don't treat terrorism quite the way we do. They feel like we're the rich people in the gated community. And we just tell them in the poor part of town, hey, fix that route, fix things up over there, and we'll send people to beat the crap out of you. And so they feel kind of annoyed. They say, we're the ones living with these people every day. We take most of the brunt. We know you had some big stuff happen to you, but we get it every day. So they get annoyed about that. So when Obama is actually trying to be more belligerent than Bush in the Northwest with his bombings and to kill civilians, it amplifies the sense that this sense that America's not with us. Now, Obama might be taking out some absolutely crucial, strategically important Taliban and Al-Qaeda targets. The problem is, when Bush was president, I wrote columns talking about how Bush was so foolish to not understand the Hydra effect, that you can kill a man but turn his whole family against you, and his sons, and so on. And I felt like that was something Bush missed out on. But when push comes to shove, I don't think Obama's any different. And I think, to me, that's a little bit of a disappointment.
Just to add, is there a proactive approach that we could take as a country in terms of better diplomacy?
Got that?
Oh, no, I was just going to say that there was, in fact, the bombings of... Well, I mean, I could speak with them.
Okay.
just to say, I just wanted to add that the bombings have, in fact, increased. And if they, over an average, if you take an average of it, it's like once a week.
Okay, in terms of
to New York or
bombings of civilians in different parts of Pakistan,
in the tribal regions.
Oh, okay, yeah, and it's happening all over Pakistan. My mother went back there a couple of weeks ago, and Islamabad's not the place it used to be. But when I was there last year, I hadn't seen the new McDonald's there before, but you gotta go through metal detectors and bomb checkers and all that to do this. So the whole area, the whole country feels under siege in a way. And it's difficult, because when you go, part of it is that when you go bomb people up north, they just go into the city south, and then they rain terror on average Joes and people like my mother and all that. And in terms of a practical way, aid is necessary. I think the best thing you can do is just pull out of Afghanistan. Not much of Al-Qaeda's there. You can save a hell of a lot of money and cut down the resentment. No magic solutions, but you don't have to keep making things worse.
I think there would have to be a great deal of pressure for educational reform in education and the distribution of land.
Yeah, that's a great point. That Pakistan has a lot of problems of feudalism, feudal lords and all that who still run a lot of the country, and they won't give up that control. India actually did a pretty good job of reforming a lot of that after partition. Pakistan didn't, and is still dealing with a lot of the consequences. That there's not a lot of fairness there. There is a lot of corruption. And I guess people remind me of this, that there's corruption all through Asia, all through Africa, all through so many of Latin America. There's tons of corruption. Pakistan's not unique in the corruption, but it sure does make it harder to get yourself out of a huge geopolitical mess like that when you've got those kinds of issues.
You just said that pulling out of Afghanistan would be the solution. I hate to say, but it seems like Al-Qaeda is not there because we are there. So if we're not there and create a vacuum, who fills the vacuum?
The question is, they've already decentralized in many ways all across the world. So they're decentralized, and it might be to their advantage to stay decentralized, because there's not a lot of great stuff going on in Afghanistan.
But they'd rather be centralized. I mean, obviously it's fun to be with my buddies all in one little huddle. And certainly, if no one is in Afghanistan, it makes a wonderful little place to huddle.
But you could make a point that being decentralized is strategically smarter for them. And so, in some ways, pull out, let them go back in, and then get them. But the point is, they're not there now. Jesse.
Rob, is it working?
Okay, thanks.
Rob, I'm glad you mentioned Wahhabism, because Islam has spread in many parts of the world, but it's originally a desert religion, and that the Arabs, it originated with the Arabs and spread into Asia and other places. And I wonder a couple of things. First of all, is it actually an appropriate, quote unquote, religion in the Asian context? And if it is possible to reform Islam, is that something that would be desirable? And how would one reform a religion that is really so decentralized and where interpretation by a broad number of people is really demanded by the religion? So what are the possibilities? Do we see a reformation like Martin Luther's in Islam as a possible cure for the things that are happening there now?
Are you asking me to criticize Islam?
Entirely up to you.
Do you ever see Stephen Colbert's book, I Am America and So Can You, where he does a chapter on religion, and it goes through and mocks each religion mercilessly and each denomination, and then he gets to Islam and he says, Islam is the one true faith with the guided by the great Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and then moves on to the next one, makes fun of them. There's something testy about conservative Muslims. I think that's a cultural thing. They can be a tough bunch, and you don't want to get caught making fun of them too much. But it is a cultural issue, I think. I think that the Middle East right now is particularly testy. There are Southeast Asians who are Muslims who are not nearly as combative as the Middle Eastern ones. This goes back to, again, some of the cultural issues. Some people are just nuts. In some parts of the world, they're just more hot-headed. But it's a great question about Martin Luther and Reformation. Now, Martin Luther was kind of a jerk in his own right, but he did help reform certain kinds of ideas, certain things, certain institutions in certain ways. That was helpful. What Islam has a very progressive strain to it. People who believe the progressive strain of Islam don't mind having a beer now and then. They don't mind having some pork to eat. They see that the reason that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, may have forbidden pork was because back in those days pork wasn't so healthy, so clean. And that they can kind of see perhaps this is what is the motivation behind the rule. And so they're not so legalistic. And I think sometimes people who have a good psychological understanding of things can separate out the issues and say, I think the spirit of the Muslim law is this. Instead of getting caught up in all the little details and then hanging each other over, you didn't follow the right detail or so forth. That there is that ability. We talked about how the Sufi impulse within Islam, the mystical tradition, oftentimes has a very much a mellowing effect on them, a little psychological awareness. And I think nowadays all societies are getting very psychologically aware. I think America actually is a very moderating influence on Islam. And that if you look at Christianity, Christians were killing each other for centuries. It was up to the 16th, 17th century, huge. The Reformation itself caused a lot of killing. It didn't mellow anybody out. It just made them all burn each other. And when did Christianity actually become a kind of a let's chill out and respect each other's personal opinion kind of thing? Was it for some reason when people came to America? And this place has a very live and let live kind of a approach here. Except when we're bombing other countries, but.
Certainly along the spectrum of interfaith journeys, conservative Islam to evangelical Christianity is a pretty extraordinary conversion. And it sounds like you had kind of an interlude of atheism or New Age faith or whatever, but what initially attracted you to evangelical Christianity?
In many ways, I was attracted to evangelical Christianity for the pacifism. That's kind of the weird part there, that I felt Islam, this might go back to a little bit what Varun was asking about before, but I felt Islam to me strikes me as a very classically monotheistic religion. It's just pure, cut and dried monotheism. My mom will tell you that's what I love about it. No trinities, no crazy doctrines that I can't figure out. God is in three places at once or whatever, and how many people is he? But he's one person, he's three. Just simple, do the right thing and believe in God and hope to make it to heaven. And I kind of liked some of the strain of the sense in which that Sermon on the Mount ethos of Jesus, that sense of this upside down world in which turn the other cheek, and that sense in which everybody else is trying to beat the crap out of each other, but somehow this is a different world way of living. What I found was that I've probably bickered with people over theology and all that. What I found was that I love this idea of focusing on the Sermon on the Mount and the idea of turning the other cheek and the idea of unconditional love and blessing your enemies and loving your enemies and all that. But sometimes I felt like we spent a lot of time talking about eschatology and soteriology and various other kinds of supralapsarianism and various doctrines and being on the right side of such and such. And personally, that was probably my own fault that I got pulled into those debates. But I ultimately sort of felt as though I wanted something in my life that was broader. But again, as I said earlier, that could be a little disappointment to some people, and makes me once again a disappointment. But I think that it forces all of us to wrestle with, so what do I believe? What do I care about? And ultimately, as I wrestle with that, honestly, others wrestle with that. And I think we all kind of grow from that. But there's friends of mine who, in this room, who have been with me sort of along the way at various points of my journey and are sort of here tonight, and to me it's a little touching kind of thing, in the sense that as many of us go in different directions of life, there's that sense in which we're actually still having strong relationships. So I think we're about to...
We have time for one more question, so if someone want to end us on a powerful note. He's the judge. I can speak.
Okay. He's a judge. He's just allowed to talk about it.
And apologize for making the question maybe somewhat personal in nature. You talk about you being a conservative Muslim. I grew up in a conservative Christian family. Is there anything that you feel you missed out on while you're growing up, or you wish you would have been exposed to? And that's some of, well, I guess the way to preface the question is, conservative family, Muslim family, but you turned out okay. And I Christian background, but I turned out okay. In terms of your growing up, do you feel like there's anything you missed out on? And if you were to go through it again, is there something you would have been exposed to, or if you had children, how would you go about walking this narrow line where you expose them to some things that you like, some things you don't? And do you think it's fair to expose them to things you don't as well?
I think this is a lot of my own stuff, my own kind of issues, is that I grew up feeling very Pakistani and wishing I wasn't. And I had no desire to stand in front of a room of people and write a book about a Pakistani-American Odyssey and talk about Pakistan, because I would want to be just an American. So in some ways, it's almost not even the Islamic thing. I think oftentimes the battles we fight over in religion are really battles about culture. Culture informs how we feel about religion, about our own religion and other people's religion. I wanted to be a total all-American. You grow up in American culture, you kind of want to celebrate, maybe I wanted to celebrate Christmas, even if I didn't give any crap about what was actually happening or who it was for. I think I was 20 before I knew what Easter was about. But it was a sense in which I really wanted to just kind of perhaps fit in. And my journey has been about trying to fit in to the group while being honest to my own values and maybe fitting in different ways. My parents told me, you ran off and you became a Christian to fit in with your Christian friends. I said, maybe. I think I had more atheist friends. That would have been easier. But it was a constantly this wrestling with that. Or people who might say, okay, so you left the church because you wanted to fit in with, you know, those people out there or whatever. But it's always been about wanting to fit in, but figuring out how can I do that while being true to what I really believe, and then all along trying to figure out what the hell I believe. So I believe we have some books back there. I do want to say personally, I'm extremely touched that friends and family and strangers would come out, and a number of you were mentioned in the book. And the acknowledgments, I thank you all. Somebody mentioned to me, he's like, you mentioned everybody you know, don't you? It's like, no, I'm sure I forgot a few of you here, but if I forgot you and you buy a book, I'll write your name in the back. So, where's Warren?
So, please join me in thanking Rob Asghar.